2 years ago, before any country in the world went into lockdown and before the World Health Organization declared COVID-19 a pandemic, Dr. Kizzmekia Corbett and her team at the National Institutes of Health had already developed a COVID-19 vaccine that was ready for testing by Moderna. In early January of 2020, the only known cases of COVID were in China, and so on January 10th, Chinese scientists published the sequencing of COVID-19. Dr. Corbett told President Biden what happened next.
When we got those sequences, because we knew how to make that protein as a very good vaccine, we did that really quickly over the weekend. And by the 13th,
over the weekend.
You know something about working on weekends, right?
Not like that.
What did you get done over this weekend? After years of vaccine research, Dr. Corbett was able to create the vaccine that became the Moderna vaccine in one weekend after the world got the scientific description of COVID-19 from Chinese scientists. That weekend of work and the years that preceded it have saved millions of lives. Joining us now on the anniversary of that weekend of life-saving work is Dr. Kizzmekia Corbett. She is now Associate Professor of Immunology and Infectious Diseases at Harvard University's School of Public Health. Dr. Corbett, thank you very much for joining us tonight and returning to the program.
Thank you for having me again.
So, first question is, you now have a choice. You can be called doctor or professor. Not a lot of people have that choice. You do. Which is your preference these days?
You know what, Lawrence, with you, I'm still affectionately Kizzy.
Yes. You got to pick a title. It's going to be professor or doctor. You know what? I'll mix them up. I'll just mix them up as we go. Take us back to that weekend, because a lot of people got the idea that this vaccine development was rushed because the administration had put the term warp speed on it as we were trying to, as we out here were trying to figure out what was going on. We were hearing vaccine experts come on this program and others and say, you know, 3 years would be fast. If they get one in 3 years, that'll be really fast for this kind of situation. But what had you been doing for the previous years that allowed you that burst on that weekend?
We'd been preparing. We had been studying other coronaviruses for so long at that time, for about 6 years, so that we knew exactly how to move in the case that this coronavirus started to circulate in China and then eventually all over the globe. So you just prepare for moments like this by studying viruses within the same viral family.
And you wrote recently about how you are not giving up. You get dispirited about it like everyone else, but you are not giving up in trying to convert people to taking the vaccine who have not wanted to or have been reluctant or have been adamantly against it. What are some of your one-on-one success stories?
There are so many, and I don't even like to call it convert. What I like to say is that I like to provide people with the bit of knowledge that they feel like they are missing in order to decide for themselves and for their families and loved ones to take the vaccine. So oftentimes what that takes is just a little one-on-one conversation, answering questions for people and reminding them that I am here on a consistent basis to do so, and that the journey that we all are taking in this pandemic, we're taking it together. And so I'm a vaccine scientist, but at the end of the day, I'm also a professor, and I am a fiance, and I am a daughter, and I am just a regular human being who also has a lot of questions. My science allows me to answer them for myself, and I just like to translate that information to every one person who asks.
You say that your approach to this is to just be ready to listen. You're not someone who walks into the room and says, hey, I worked on the vaccine. Who wants to know about it?
You know what? I actually prefer not to walk into rooms that way. Yeah. Because oftentimes I get bombarded if I do. But, you know, for me, where we are in this moment, in the wake of the Omicron variant, where people, only about 60% of us adults in this country have been vaccinated, we are in this moment where we really need to approach this with a little bit of tenderness and with a listening ear. And so that's where I stand. I don't go about boasting about the vaccine data, although it is continuously beautiful. I just really just listen to people. And then if they have a question, I say, would you like me to answer that? I leave the floor open for them at all times so that they are, if they are willing, they can have their question answered.
You said in your USA Today article, I lead by listening.
I lead by listening. I think that is really all that any of us can do in this moment. You know, that 40% of people have decided for whatever reason that they are still not going to take the vaccine, although the data consistently shows that the vaccine is protecting people, particularly against the most severe disease and against death. So if those 40% of people have made that decision, they clearly have an obstacle that is preventing them from going to take the vaccine. And oftentimes that is one or two things that they have on their mind. And so I listen to those things firstly, and then I provide my stance as a scientist, as someone who is very critical about all of the data that comes out, not just the vaccine data.
Vice President Harris got the Moderna vaccine. Anthony Fauci got the Moderna vaccine. They both did it on TV. I got the Moderna vaccine at Dodger Stadium. So I'm thanking you for all of us for developing that. What do we know about how the vaccines are dealing with Omicron, and what is the future of these vaccines in this battle against COVID-19?
We know that the vaccines are continuously protecting people against severe illness, hospitalization, and death, even in the wake of Omicron, particularly those people who have gotten their boosters. And so those booster shots are really a way for you to awaken your immune system, to really excite your immune system again, to say, hey, if the virus comes your way, you are ready to fight against that virus, even if it looks a little bit different, as Omicron certainly does. It does look a little bit different. But with a boosted vaccinated person, those people are fighting that virus away, and they are keeping themselves out of the hospital, which is really important as the hospitals are overwhelmed. And that is really the downside of this pandemic and potentially any parts of any other wave in this pandemic.
Is there more research going on that might somehow adjust the vaccines for the coming threats?
Of course. Every single time, I just put this on my Instagram story last week, someone else asked this question. Every single time a different variant comes along, we pull all of our heads together and we do research to determine whether or not it is appropriate to change the vaccine to match that specific variant. So far, we have shown that it has not been necessary to change the insert of the vaccine, that the original vaccine with a booster tends to be showing that it is not appropriate that you need to change it, that people are being protected against severe illness, hospitalization, and death. The further we go out with different variants, perhaps that might change. But so far, the data is showing that we are in the clear with these original vaccine sequences. The data for Omicron is going to continue to come out, but we show that with previous variants, and the data in real time with people in the hospitals are continuing to show that these vaccines, particularly in boosted people, are being protective.